Hello, everybody, and thank you very much for coming. Our guest today is a phenomenon, I think I can say. Stephen Hough is one of the world's foremost pianists. It's been said, excuse me, is it on? Can you hear me? I'll speak up until you do. One of the great, who's said to evoke the golden age of the great piano virtuosi of the early 20th century. He's recorded over 50 CDs across an enormous range of repertoire, and I've read reviews of every single one. I can't find one that hasn't been extraordinary. Many have won international awards. He is an increasingly commissioned composer, a prize-winning poet, a painter. Stephen, you've very gratifyingly had an exhibition at something called the Broadbent Gallery, I gather. He's written a wonderful book about prayer. He's a journalist, and he will soon, I think as soon as next month, be a published novelist. He won the Nuremberg International Piano Competition in 1983. 2001, he became the first musician to be awarded a MacArthur Prize Fellowship, the so-called Genius Award. Economists recently described him as one of 20 living polymaths, and he was this year voted, I noticed, by the readers of Limelight magazine as Artist of the Year, quotes, not because he is a thinking musician, which he is, but because he's a kind of philosopher king whose demean is all of art and therefore of life. So, Stephen, welcome.
I think I should leave. It can only go down from there. Thank you.
Thank you very much for finding the time to come to the Bank of England. We know how busy your life is. So where have you just come from?
I was in America. I was in New York.
Giving concerts.
Well, spending a lot of time at the airport because of weather issues, which I think all of us have faced. But no, I was playing concerts over there, yes.
And your next concert is?
Is Detroit. I'm going back there, going to the Caribbean actually for a holiday over the new year, and then the first weekend of the new year I'll be in with the Detroit Symphony. Right.
Yeah. Now, I should try and explain to you and the audience something about this event. So last year the bank decided to hold a series of what we call flagship seminars, where inviting distinguished people who have nothing whatever to do with central banking. So amongst others, you follow, for example, we've had Tamara Rojo, the dancer, we've had the boxing promoter Barry Hearn, very entertaining, Grayson Perry, and the great West Indian cricketer Michael Holding. And you might wonder why we're doing this, and if you were cynical, you'd no doubt think it's just an excuse for a bunch of faceless bureaucrats to get to meet more interesting people. And you'd be right, of course. It is right. But we do at least invite everyone in from the outside. We're live streaming this, and the intention, I should say, is that you will have plenty of time. I'm going to try and keep to 40 minutes to ask Stephen questions of your own. But we're very grateful, not least because some of your antecedents have warned you off people like us. I said that some critics have said you've revived the playing and indeed some of the music from what's called the golden age of great pianists. I found this book. Many of them, of course, and they're living in the United States. This great book, Great Pianists on Piano Playing, was published in the US a century ago. And I'm going to try and make this work now. They seem to have very firm views about life, including people like us, as I say. So this is the great Polish pianist, Joseph Hoffman, warning you off what he calls well-meaning admirers. And if you're meant to distinguish between, quotes, the case of real appreciation or more mere morbid mania to hobnob with celebrities, well, I'm sure you'll find both here, actually. But it's actually the second bit of this quote I wanted to begin with, Stephen, when he says celebrities, or at least people who by nature of their professional work are often compelled against their own desires to hold a more or less exposed position in the public eye. And what I want to talk to you a little about is the contrast, it seems to me, between the personality that's necessary to be able to spend hours in his youth locked away in a room on his own, on the one hand, and yet the personality that's required to go out and perform to a hall of 1,000, 2,000 people. But perhaps we can begin at the beginning with that. You were born, I think, on the Wirral, an only child, and so no brothers and sisters, and indeed no piano either, to begin with, is that right?
That's right, just a television set, yes.
So how did you come across the instrument to begin with?
Well, I had an aunt who had a piano, and we would visit her, and it was always very boring, the conversation, and so I would go over and try and play the nursery rhymes that I'd learned on this piano, and I just thought this was the most amazing thing I'd ever seen. And so I begged my parents, could I have piano lessons, could we have a piano? So they bought me, first of all, a piano. Well, it's about the size, I suppose, of this, this keyboard here, which was not very satisfying, a little toy piano. And then eventually, a wonderful rosewood German upright piano for £5 from an antique shop in Stockton Heath. And so I started lessons, and I think my mother just got the Yellow Pages out, if you remember the Yellow Pages, and looked under piano teachers and found the one that lived closest to where we lived, like you'd try and find someone to fix the drains. And Miss Riley came to give me these piano lessons. So, I've spoken about dear Miss Riley before. She was a ferocious lady, orange lipstick, orange nail polish, henna hair, unmarried, Miss Riley. She was very, I mean, that's a very typical archetype, isn't it? The unmarried piano teacher. Children are her students. And she would come and sort of terrorize me for half an hour and then leave. But I do remember that I would memorize the things that she'd asked me to do very quickly. And so she was getting into her Fiat 500 bubble car outside. And I was saying to my mother, well, can she come back? Because I've learned the pieces she's set me for next week. I want another piano lesson now. So I think my mother could see that I was really very keen on playing the piano. So it kind of developed from there.
And you did take to it immediately in that way.
Oh, I was. My mother had to drag me away from the piano to go and get some fresh air because I wanted to play all the time. I was writing music, all rubbish, but just the physical act of writing it on the page, sight reading, learning, I just couldn't. The piano was all I wanted to do at that time.
And do you think that, I've heard you in the past describe yourself as shy, or at least as having been shy at that age. Do you think the ability or the willingness to work, I'm not sure you had this enormous gift, but did that go hand in hand with a personality that was introverted in any way? Or?
I suppose so. I think if you learn, particularly the piano, because the pianist is someone who travels alone. If you play the violin or cello, you know, you usually have someone, a pianist, with you. So you have to learn to live alone if you want a life as a concert pianist. And so in a way, my time in Thelwall, Cheshire, was a good training for this, to be alone. I had friends, of course, at school, but no brothers and sisters, and time to spend at the piano. And it's continued, although I had this period in my early teens when I didn't want to play at all. I completely lost interest, but that was just one of those phases. But yes, it's interesting. This has stuck in my mind since you brought this up at the beginning. I really think there's something terrible about that statement.
No, I agree. Well, I've got another one that's even worse.
You know, another lady from the north, Betty Driver. I don't know whether you remember her from Coronation Street. She was beloved barmaid. And I got to know her quite well at the end of her life. And we went out for dinner a few times in a Cheshire pubs. And people would always, of course, recognize her and come over and want her autograph and things. And I remember asking her, did that ever bother her? And unlike Joseph Hoffman, she said not at all. Because in a sense, she felt that really was part of what she chose to be an actress, and she chose to be on the television. Yep. And therefore, that comes with the people who pay your salary and are the people who love you and who want to have some connection with you. And so I think anyone who chooses to leave the wings and walk out onto the stage and sit in front of the piano, first of all, I think it's marvellous that anyone even wants to come. I mean, I can't say that I want to throw away the people who might want to be at the concerts, but I think we're in this together, and I really feel that an audience is not doesn't take a passive role in this. To me, the best audiences are the ones who are involved by their listening, and listening to great music is an active thing. You don't just sit back and let it happen. You actually, if you like, lean forward and are absorbed in it. And you can tell when an audience has that kind of thing. So I don't feel I'm just playing as an entertainment and people are absorbing it. No. I feel that all of us together are experiencing Beethoven, Chopin, Brahms, whatever it might be. And so in so many ways, that statement is...
Indeed.
I adore a lot of what Joseph Hoffman did in his recordings, but I think he was wrong about that.
Well, he's certainly a very stern-looking person in that photograph. I looked for a photograph where he was smiling, but I couldn't find one. The interpreting as generous as I could, I saw that as partly saying that he himself maybe was an introvert and felt crowded by the public nature of...
I think so. I mean, he had a very complex life because he was really a child star and, in fact, had to be taken out of the public eye during his mid-teens.
Well, I can make it worth talking of work, and I found another. They are very stern, these people. So, Godofsky, the reason I asked you about work is because I know how much it involves. So, Godofsky, they're pretty direct about how much you have to work. And there is Hoffman again. Mm-hmm. It really gets into his stride. The young person who cannot concentrate is not likely to be a conspicuous success in any line of activity.
But I wouldn't quarrel with that.
No, well, I think that's
actually
probably true.
No, those are, I'd
it's
like
just
to
rather
take
direct.
Those. I'd like to use those. because I think concentration is something that is really in danger of being lost in our 21st century world. I think for all of us, really, I include people who have to concentrate. It seems to me that one of the most important things a young person can learn is to concentrate, especially if they're going to become a brain surgeon or a pilot or something that requires concentration to keep people's lives in your hands. And I think this is one of the great things about learning a musical instrument. If we're talking about music education, it's a sort of shortcut, if you like, to learn how to concentrate. Because if you learn a musical instrument, then you are forced into focusing in a way that you're not with many other subjects. So, now I would take on board those very much. And he's got a slight smile, Godofsky, hasn't he?
You know, Godofsky does smile a little more. But, you know, the fact is a lot of musicians I know do, I think, tend to view pianists as slightly odd people, because only odd people could lock themselves away and spend so many hours on their own. And I've read... there are a number of psychological studies that find that pianists seem to have traits of introverts. Mm. And yet, on the other hand, they also have traits of extroversion in having to play. And that struck me when I remember when I first saw you play, Stephen, which was many, many years ago on telly when you won the first... BBC, the piano final of the BBC Young Musician of the Year, and I heard you play the Liszt B minor sonata. And Liszt himself was, of course, this archetypal virtuoso performer, the first in a way. Mm. When you played that sonata, or when you played a lot of Liszt in your life, was the part of you, even as a teenager, which wanted to be the great performer, the sort of Lisztian performer, or was it just the music?
I think with that piece, it was just the music. I mean, that piece was written when he had withdrawn away from the concert world, when he was in Weimar. He took this position in Weimar for all sorts of reasons, I think, when he was in his mid-30s, I think. And he wanted to write more music, and he couldn't travel as he had done in his 20s and do the serious things that he wanted to do. So his life took a real change, and that sonata is around the time that this is, this is happening, in that period of rich creativity. I think this conflict between the private and the public person is absolutely true, though. And I've been very conscious of this. I remember one year playing at the Hollywood Bowl in Los Angeles, and it was 17,000 people there. It's not the normal size of an audience. But, you know, I was playing in front of 17,000 people, and half an hour later, I was eating a hamburger in my hotel room alone. And I was conscious of that being an astonishing contrast and schizophrenia, really, in a way. I think the other contrast is that we have to be, of course, supremely sensitive on stage, dealing with the music, working with those notes, but then so much of what we do, we have to be really tough. And, you know, the constant travelling, the constant annoyances that you have with delayed flights and hotel rooms with banging in the next room and so many other things and receptions after concerts that might be boring. But then you're expected suddenly to become someone supremely sensitive in front of the piano. And then off stage, supremely, you have to be able to tough it out in all sorts of ways. So I think that's one of the requirements that people maybe don't think about when they're learning to play the piano at a music school.
And when you were learning, so let's go back a bit. After your first teacher, then, just fill me in a bit, how long were you with
Miss Riley?
Miss Riley.
Just a few months. It's a slightly long story, but my mother had a friend whose daughters were studying at the Royal Northern College of Music. And when she saw that I was more than usually interested, she took me to see this friend and her daughters. And they said, you know, that they'd like to teach me. So I began studying with Heather Slade Lipkin, who then was a student of Gordon Green, who then was my teacher after that. So that was the sort of progression there. And it was good. I think Miss Riley was a character, but she was not going to help me to play well. Those early years are so important. The famous teachers that we hear about in music colleges, well, yes, they do a lot of wonderful things, but the really important person is the one who's laying the foundations. Yeah. Like a building, really. I mean, you can do all sorts of beautiful decorative things, but if the foundations are not solid, then there's not much point because it won't stand up. And so those teachers that get forgotten, I really think we should be celebrating them more, the ones who teach kids from, you know, the age of 4 to 10. That's when the real work happens.
And when you were that age, I mean, at what stage did you think this could be something I do all my life, or did that thought never occurred to you until you were much older?
Oh, I think from the first day of having piano lessons, I thought this is what I wanted to do. The doubts came later, but in the early years when you don't know anything, of course, yes, I want to be a concert pianist. And I thought wanting to be one was being
sufficient.
One was sufficient.
Yes.
Of course, you find out that that's not true, but I think it's also was very different in those days. I think people now have so much more awareness of careers and of fame and of how many people you have as friends on your Facebook. That whole world was just not there then. So, you know, in a Cheshire village, I had no idea what a concert pianist was. I didn't go to many concerts. We went to the Liverpool Phil once a month or something like that. So I heard some wonderful things there, but I wasn't in the middle of a world of performers. So I didn't know what a concert pianist was. I had some LPs and I saw pictures of pianists on the front. I thought, well, when I'm older, maybe I could be one of those too.
Right. And what did your parents make of all this?
They were great, actually. Neither of them are alive anymore, but they were incredibly supportive, but never pushy. And that's, to me, the best combination you can possibly have. I've seen many parents who you see wanting to live their own thwarted ambition through their kids, which is a terrible thing, and then other children who have no encouragement at home. But I had both. Really, if I'd wanted to stop playing, I don't think there would have been a question. That's fine, but the fact that I wanted to, you know, they drove me, you know, considerable distance on Saturdays for my piano lessons, and my father with Gordon Green used to sit in the lessons and make notes, and he and Gordon had wonderful conversations about politics. They both had rather interesting radical views. They both smoked pipes and would discuss pipe tobacco and Tony Benn, and various other people came up in the course of those interesting Saturday morning conversations. His wife had been a dancer, and she was also a very interesting lady. She'd come in with coffee and biscuits, and Gordon Green always had many interesting books open on his desk, and he was a cultured man, and completely against piano competitions, unlike so many teachers. I did mention at one point about wanting to enter some, and he said, no, think about this, and maybe in about 10 years. You know, just he wanted me to experiment, to make mistakes. I would have been, I suppose, about 15 at the time, maybe. And he said, really, what interests me is how you're going to play in 10 years' time. I don't care really how you play now. And so he was completely against the kind of grooming. You can make people sound good by artificially saying, take a little time here and don't rush here and so on. But he left many things, looking back, in bad taste, even technical problems. He wanted me to take time to discover those. Because then I think you have a much broader palette to work with. And it really bothers me when I see young people. I give quite a lot of masterclasses and I hear youngsters and you know, people 15, 16, 17, already, when can I become famous? When can I start making? Why? You know, you haven't got anything yet to say. You're fantastically talented, but yes, work with that. You know, try different things out. Go down a false path. You've got the time at 15, at 16.
So you went through this period when you sort of lost interest.
Yeah, yeah.
And did he mind then?
I still went for my piano lessons. I just about prepared enough so that it wasn't a disgrace. But I look back now, I could have got so much more out of him. He died when I was about 18, I think. And in a way, I remember not long before he died, I used to call him Mr. Green. He said, I think you're old enough now, my dear boy, to call me Gordon. Which is a very amazing moment, really, but rather special. And so, I was tongue-tied trying to say that word. But I think we could have had a much better relationship and a more fruitful, rich relationship if we'd both been, well, if I'd been older, yeah. I'd been able to ask him things. Same with my father. He died when I was 20. So many things I would like to have asked him about. Mm. And of course, that's what it is. You know, people die too young sometimes. Yeah.
And I haven't put in some of the other quotes from here, maybe some of the kinder ones. Two things crop up very often in these little interviews, which are fascinating. One, which maybe we'll come back to, is the sort of universal reverence for Bach at a time when Bach wasn't as fashionable as he is now, which I found interesting. The other is how many people say that musicians should have, as far as possible, a broad education and should not, despite the hours of practice that are needed, focus too narrowly from too young an age on the music, and that their playing will in the end benefit from knowing about art and science and literature and so forth. You went to the music school Cheetham's at what age?
10.
At 10. And looking back, do you feel you had enough of that? I mean, my introduction reveals, it seems to me it's hard to imagine anyone more broadly educated, but at the time, did you feel you were missing out on other things?
Well, I did so little when I was at school. I mean, almost all that I've done really has been, in a self-taught after I left school. I got a C in my history O-level, and history fascinates me now. I'm always reading something. I have to say that Cheetham's is now a terrific place, and I was there this week, and I was teaching the kids, and everything from the facilities down to the faculty is really wonderful. When I was there, it was a totally chaotic place. It had some wonderful teachers, some terrible teachers. They had all sorts of issues, of course, that now are very much solved with, with issues of abuse and so on. It was a mess, really, and I would have been much better going to my local high school, I think, or somewhere like Manchester Grammar School, if I've been able to get in, somewhere like that. So no, I've been madly trying to catch up since. and I think it's true. It's ironic, though, that someone like Joseph Hoffman, it seems to me, did spend all of his childhood playing the piano. So yes. It's ironic if he felt that later.
Many of them appear to, as I say. So you went to Cheetham's. First saw you on the telly when you were 16, and were you by then performing already, or did Chet's make you give concerts regularly and so forth? Or
not really. I didn't actually get to play a concerto with the school orchestra when I was there. Many others did, but probably because I was watching 6 hours of television a day and not doing very much work.
And I would. What did you watch?
Oh, the worst things. Crossroads,
Tony Hatch,
Armadale Farm.
Good theme song.
Tony Hatch. Yeah, well, he made a lot of money, didn't he, out of those theme songs. Yeah. Coronation Street. I don't know, I had these years, maybe 2 or 3 years of just doing very little of being, it's a little complicated, I suppose. I had a terrible fear of being mugged. I was going to school in Manchester and going in on the bus, and then I was mugged. So in a sense, the fear was...
Turns out to be justified. Yeah.
So I ended up having almost a year off school, and I think I lost... I lost my way a little bit in that year, and it was difficult for me to catch up, and then I didn't really want to catch up. But things took off when I went to the Royal Northern. Gordon Green actually said, I just think you should leave that school, forget about your A-levels, come here early, and we'll get you on the graduate bachelor degree course, which I just managed to scrape in, I think, 2 weeks before they changed the rules, when you had to have A-levels to get on it. So I was 2 years ahead when I was there, and that really gave me a nice start. So I did well at the RNCM, and then I did. I went to do a master's degree at Juilliard in New York.
And how was
that? And I loved that. Especially, we had a wonderful literature teacher from Columbia University, actually, who came down to teach us history of Western culture. And she was fantastic. And I thought, gosh, this is really what I should have been doing for the last 7 years. I mean, why do I have this huge big gap in my education? So I was very much encouraged by all of that. It's happened since then that I've been reading constantly.
And you took to New York.
I loved New York. It was the first place that I truly lived away from home. And I loved it from the second I arrived for my audition at Juilliard. I stayed in the Empire Hotel, which then had metal doors. So it was very exciting. I was bulletproof in that time. We didn't have bulletproof doors in Cheshire. It was very exciting. And I made many friends. And I worked quite hard, but also had a lot of fun and played around. We used to sit and smoke cigarettes in the corridors. The thing there is you had to put a score on the piano to seal the room for your practice. But once it was there, then you could leave for 15 minutes without losing the room. So people would put their score on their Chopin preludes on the piano, leave and sit and gossip. And then as long as you went back within 15 minutes to make sure no one else had taken it, you could keep it like that for the whole day. It was a bit like sort of feeding a parking meter in a way. And so a lot of time was spent like that. In fact, the people who did the best when I was at Juilliard were the ones who worked the least. I don't know whether that was true in universities too, but sometimes.
Quite possibly. And you've since toured a lot in the US. As I say, all these players made their living in the United States. How much of your playing is in the US now?
Well, a lot, really. In a way, all of the opportunities that I had from Juilliard through to winning the Nuremberg and through to the MacArthur came from the States. So I've always enjoyed playing there. It's been a great place to work. And I've played now in, I think, 46 states and some of those states, multiple times. I was just in Hawaii a few months ago. It was nice to be able to tick off another one. I've got a few more to go.
What's left? 46. What a shame not to have the 50. Surely you've got...
Well, eventually I will. Idaho, Mississippi, and Arkansas, I think, are the three. I don't think those three have huge musical lives. But I shouldn't say that because in the most unlikely places, Kansas City, for instance, you don't think of as maybe a musical center, but it has two fantastic recital series where everyone goes to play. So that's the middle of the country. America's full of surprises in so many ways.
Indeed. And are you social? I think this is next thing. I wanted to show you this just because it's slightly preposterous. I think this is Emil Sara, who is a German pianist, who, again, very, very exacting. On tour, I refrain from social pleasures of all kinds. My mind and my body must be right or failure will result. And I like this bit. He says, I've often had people say to me after the performance of some particularly brilliant number, they're all brilliant, but after particularly brilliant numbers, you must have taken a bottle of... Nothing could be further from the truth. Very stern. So are you... Do you carefully abstemious, or is it late suppers when you're in the US or on tour?
Well, I don't
generally
drink a bottle of champagne before a performance, that's for sure. And actually, I don't like champagne very much. But, no, in fact, quite the contrary. I think after a performance, one of the nicest things is to be with some friends and to have dinner. I mean, not wild until 4 in the morning, although I have had occasions like that. one occasion actually like that was in London. I learned this lesson quite early. I think it was the London Philharmonic, and we played a concert in London. And the next day we were to play an out-of-town concert. And I was out till about 4 o'clock in the morning after that concert. I was only about 23 at the time. And I thought, well, I haven't had much sleep, but I'll sleep backstage in the afternoon. I'll have a nap on a sofa somewhere. I found there was no sofa, nowhere to get a nap at all. So during the performance, and I really am ashamed to admit this, I actually fell asleep in the performance. The orchestra were playing, and I just nodded off. And a bit like when you're driving on the motorway and you nod off, it's terrifying. And of course, you're then absolutely awake and alert. So I learned a lesson, and so Azawa is quite
correct. You woke up in time.
Yes. I woke up in time to come in, yes. Well, I mean, it was probably half a second, but it was...
There's a passage in here where Busoni says that he works out how to play something during a tutti. He's playing a concerto, and he said, there's some bit coming up, which I could never have to work it out. And he said, suddenly the solution came to me. And he waited for a very loud tutti and then tried it out.
Oh, God.
You haven't?
No, I've never done that, really. I think a lot of people, you know, we find playing concertos that during the tutties, the mind can play all sorts of strange games, and you can think to yourself, I bet you don't know what your next entry is, do you? You know, those sort of things. And you have to be very careful not to go down those lines. And again, like driving, you can't watch the car that's going. You have to keep your eyes focused on what's going ahead.
And indeed, and you have repeating themes. And
yeah.
Have you ever had a major slip of memory? Or
early in my career, I had one, yeah. And this was 1984. When I took a wrong turn in a Mozart concerto, where it is easier because, of course, the material comes back in a different key, and you can take a wrong turning. But this was in the early stages. You know, those early stages after winning the Nuremberg, I was 21 in the September of 1983, and I had no idea of having a career at that point. I was enjoying sitting in the corridors, keeping the Chopin preludes on the piano, and gossiping and having fun, and then suddenly I had to grow up. And I was very, very tired. I learned, I think, 1 year, 10 new concertos, playing them all for the first time, and, you know, in a big pressure, and traveling a lot across the Atlantic. And this particular tour, it was actually with the Bournemouth Sinfonietta, which no longer exists. It was a sort of wing of the Bournemouth Symphony Orchestra. And I remember it very clearly, and I was really just desperately tired. And here we were on this little tour, we were somewhere in the West Country, and I took a wrong turn in that in a Mozart concerto.
Yeah.
And it sounded horrendous. Then the orchestra stopped, and I thought, well, the thing to do is not to stop and to keep a serene look on the face. So I carried on playing, and I found my way to the cadenza, where then I was playing alone, and then the orchestra knew when to come in after that. And it was pretty terrifying, actually. But then afterwards, and I'm ashamed to admit this, someone came backstage and said, gosh, you know, the orchestra didn't do so well. And I'm ashamed to say I didn't either deny or affirm. Yes, I just
nodded.
Said nothing. Looked at my shoes.
Whatever's happened to the Bournemouth Sinfonia. Now, as I said at the beginning, that you know you recorded this astonishing amount of music, but also astonishing range. And I'm ashamed to say I didn't even know until I looked at all your website that you recorded Mozart. I found your Mozart CD. You're about to release a Debussy CD, I heard.
Yeah.
Now, I have the impression, you must correct me if I'm wrong, that the repertoire for live concerts, certainly for the big ones that really pull in the crowd, is narrower than the range that you've recorded. Is that a fair... I mean, how many times have you played the Rachmaninoff Paganini variations, for example?
A lot.
Yeah. And do you... I mean, I meet quite a few musicians who, for whom particular pieces have been spoiled just by having to play them too often. Do you suffer from that at all?
And just last week, I often think of the world of the actor as an inspiration. And I went to see Hello, Dolly in New York with Bette Midler. It's been going for about a year, 7 shows a week for a year, and this is at the end of, it closes, that she leaves the show in January. And I thought, my goodness, you know, this is a 71-year-old, and she was absolutely on fire. And she'd already done a matinee the same day I went on the Saturday. I thought, well, this is a lesson to us who play these pieces I mean, she's done more Hello Dollies than I've done Rachmaninoff Rhapsodies.
Yeah.
If she can still be inspired with that, then I can with Rachmaninoff or with Beethoven, with anything else. And I think one of the key things about saying you want to be a concert pianist is saying you want to play concerts and you want to play this repertoire numerous times, yeah, all the time, and that every time you will be excited by it.
Yeah.
Because if you're not, then you're in the wrong business. And I can't imagine, I don't play anything now that I'm not excited to play. There were times when I was starting up that I would learn pieces that were asked of me. I remember learning the John Ireland piano concerto very much at the beginning. And it's a charming piece in a way, but I wouldn't want to play it for a whole year, seven times a week, I think.
Right. And you can now afford to be quite selective.
A little bit more. Yeah. But, you know, playing the Brahms concertos, the Beethoven concertos, and actually also Rachmaninoff and other, I mean, these are amazing. It just seems, so far, I've never found that I've been bored playing anything, and I just find it more and more exciting to each time I do. And actually, the more you play, then the more freedom you have, because, you know, so a piece settles in, you get to know it in a way, not that it becomes boring, but that it becomes familiar, so that, like with a friend that you know very well, you can actually go into all sorts of interesting areas that you can't do with someone that you meet for the first time.
I quite like this from Rubinstein on that point. He says, like making love, the act is always the same, but each time it's different.
Well, I won't say those exact words, but yeah. No, that's a great statement. And I think you felt this with Rubinstein, didn't you? That, you know, even in his old, you could see the joy in his playing and the complete. He loved being at the piano. And I suppose there are two kinds of pianists. There are the ones like Rubinstein, who just had this physical love of being in front of the instrument. And then there are others where you feel it was a little bit of a torture, like maybe Michelangeli, or in some senses Horowitz, who dealt with all kinds of neuroses about being on stage. I can't see Rubinstein cancelling unless he physically could not get to the instrument, whereas Rubinstein, you know, just might brush his finger against a brick wall and cancel a month of concerts. You know, there's a different attitude, and I think you see it. They're both wonderful players, but there's a very different way of approaching music and the piano.
Yeah.
But that's great, isn't it? Wanting to risk, to dare. I think for audiences too, music should be a risk. You know, it should seem exciting. It should be something that's never, you know, the minute it's routine, the minute it's predictable, then it's lost its magic.
Yeah, you sound so charming, and not that it's on point, but I did add one thing, because I love, maybe I'm not going to come back to that in a moment. Before, I just want to ask you a couple of things before I open it up, two particular areas. One, Stephen, is about religion. Two things one's never meant to talk about, religion and politics. I'm about to talk about both, one after the other. So you converted to Catholicism around the time you left school, or just afterwards?
Yeah, I think it's about 18.
And it said you thought about entering the priesthood a couple of times. As I say, you published this wonderful book called The Bible as Prayer. You've written several pieces of sacred music, I think. And I have to ask you this, you're about to publish a novel, and I'm simply reading from the publisher's blurb, Stephen, so forgive me, in which a Catholic priest meditates about his uncontrollable cravings for sex and the loss of his faith, on the basis that people are meant to write what they know. should we read anything into this?
Well, you can know things by research as well as by... No, I think that anyone's relationship, I think, with faith is complicated.
Yeah.
And, you know, the Catholic Church is a complicated institution in so many ways. It's been around for 2,000 years. It's had a lot of time to make mistakes, and it's certainly made good use of that time. and it's still an important part of my life. I would say that when I first became a Catholic, I was completely intoxicated by everything to do with it, and and I look back, and I don't envy that naivety, but I certainly, if I'd become a priest at that time, I would have been, well, maybe not the craving for sexuality, but I would have probably lost my faith at this point, or been in certain ways. So this novel is looking into the soul of someone. What do you do if, as a priest, you no longer, your faith is actually the material of what you do, and what do you do if that's gone? And it's also involved in a blackmail situation in the plot of the novel. So, but it was an interesting one because I have thought a lot about what it is to be involved in the desolation of losing something that's central to you. So that's what I wanted to explore with that. But I would say now that I'm delighted to hear about the new Bishop of London. I would say that my faith is very much broader. Of course, if those who haven't heard about it, it's I can't remember her name, but her name. So I would say that it's a much broader kind of faith than I have. I'm very much interested in how Judaism is totally the roots of everything that a Christian does, and not just roots in the sense it's something that comes before what comes above, but something which is at the same time. And I think we cannot understand anything to do with a Christian faith without having a deep reverence for the Jewish faith too. And other things, I think the idea that someone doesn't believe at all is very rich, and I'm always interested in knowing why. And usually I like that honesty, and I think it's important to be unafraid of examining that. And certainly all the wisdom in the world did not come from the Middle East spreading out to Europe, that, you know, there were so many years of other people saying wiser things even in the Far East and so on, and in traditional religions from Australia and America and everything else. So I think I'm interested in how all of that ties together.
Now, as I say, I would ask you about politics, or maybe not about politics necessarily, but about whether you feel that as a, with such a public life, you have any responsibility, or a musician in general, saying you individually, has any responsibility other than to the music, other than an aesthetic responsibility, if you like. And I hope this is going to work, and I've just put it up just because it was in the news recently. So,
you know, our profession, the musical profession, is the only one that is not national. No German musician will tell you, I am a German musician and I will only play Brahms, Schumann and Beethoven. Very good proof of it tonight. If, let me stay out of Great Britain, if a French citizen wants to learn Goethe, he has to have a translation. But he doesn't need a translation for the Beethoven symphonies. This is why music is so important. This is why music is so important. And this isolationist tendencies and nationalism in its very narrow sense is something that is very dangerous and can only be fought with a real great accent on the education of the new generation. We are probably all too old for that. But the new generations, they have to understand that Greece and Germany and France and Denmark have all something in common called European culture.
So, I'm not going to ask if you would ever do something similar, but, and of course, Barenboim got into some trouble, or at least the BBC got into trouble for allowing him to do this, but do you think he's, I mean, I can think of a number of other fields which are necessarily international, and there are lots of academic fields where there's enormous collaboration, but do you agree with him that music is particularly suited unavoidably to breaking down these barriers? And more generally, would you ever feel you have a responsibility, more than the musical one, political or moral, would you ever change what or where you play on the basis of any consideration?
It's a very big question, isn't it, really? I think people, there's a sort of division between those who feel that the fact you're on stage in public gives you a responsibility to make a difference or to try and make a difference, and others who feel that precisely, in a sense, what he's saying is that music being this universal language means that you can communicate not just across all political divides, but all divides of opinion. Mm-hmm. And I must say that when I'm playing a concert, I like the fact that I can play for an audience, and people there will be people in that audience with whom I'll profoundly disagree about things, politically, religiously, socially, in all sorts of different ways. And maybe afterwards, at the reception that Sauer so hated going to, we can talk about things and have an agreement. But I really feel that that is a moment when we can all rise above our own views on these different things. And I treasure that. I treasure that I can play in Japan and not be able to speak perhaps to half the audience in words, but that we have this incredible communication through the music. I can play in Mississippi, and maybe have different views about political issues, and yet somehow for the course of the Beethoven concerto or whatever else, we can be friends. And to me, that is something that's very precious. We need our politicians to do important work and our diplomats to do important work, but we also need some people to lift everyone, regardless of not just their ethnic background, their national background, but also sometimes the background of their opinions, which we may find different. I know it's not always been true in history that music is something which has changed people for the good. George Steiner talks about the chilling example of people working in Auschwitz during the day and then going back and having Schubert evenings in their houses at the end of the day. And of course, that's the final argument for those who say that art always elevates people. It doesn't, unfortunately. People can be monsters and still be very sensitive about art. But still, I would rather... I don't want to stand up in front of an audience and give a sermon on politics, on religion or anything else. I think it's not the place for it. Mm. There are times, and I think certainly it's possible... if you're invited to give a talk, to raise controversial things. But I do think there's something sacred about the musical moment that is there for everybody, whether they're criminals, whether they're saints, whether whatever, that somehow there's a healing element there. So I haven't done that. I've played, I suppose, in countries where I wouldn't necessarily feel comfortable with everything that happens. Mm. As a gay man, I've played in countries where I might be arrested, actually, I suppose.
Yeah.
And I think there are points in history when I would have said no, for sure. I think it was amazing that Gary Graffman famously in the 60s refused to play for a segregated audience in the South, in the southern states of America. I hope I'd have the courage to do something similar. I would find it very difficult to have played in Nazi Germany in front of that amazing film that was just, I saw a clip of recently, about the Berlin Philharmonic and the history of them. You have this extraordinary scene of Goebbels giving a speech, sitting down in the front row, and then they continue to play a Beethoven symphony. I couldn't do that. But I think there are moments when maybe you can say, let me try and do something with my music.
Yeah. Even and yet I think it was Barenboim who, in, as it happens, persuaded, for example, the Israeli Philharmonic to play Wagner, which they'd always refused to play.
Yeah, well, he very much feels, doesn't he, that this sense of music being this
Indeed.
International language.
Now, I've hogged far... I could go on asking you questions for hours. I've hogged far too much time. I don't know how we're... Is there somebody? Yes, no. You should have spent the last 40 minutes thinking of interesting questions. I can see, when I used to teach, the larger the group... Oh, there is a question.
We need a long stick.
The most inaccessible place for the microphone. That's all right.
Hi, I just want to ask, like, I think more and more people start taking up music nowadays. And I think some people might do, like, better than the others. I think, like, to what extent you think how much of it is down to, like, a talent inborn in a person? Or how much of it is, like, because of the hard work? Like, if you think someone put in enough effort, like, everyone can play as good as the others.
Yeah. Well, it's obviously both. It's talent and hard work. I think everyone can learn a musical instrument. I don't know whether that's something... You said a lot of people are studying music today. In a sense, I wish it were even more true than it is. But yeah, learning a musical instrument is a skill, like learning to ride the bicycle. And I think almost everyone can. Not everyone's going to be good at it. But I think it would be a marvelous thing if it was something that was routinely happening in our schools. Partly because of what we talked about earlier, yeah. I think it is one of the best ways to train a young mind to concentrate, not just on music, but on everything. And I think if we learn musical instruments, not only is it great fun to do, I think nobody regrets in later life having learned a musical instrument when they were a child, but I think it's actually it's a wonderful way to teach people, not just to concentrate, but also to be comfortable on their own. And I think this is something... Was it Pascal that said something about all our unhappiness comes from not being able to spend time in a room on our own? You know, and I think this is something also that would be very valuable for that. So let's have more and let's have as much talent as we can and the hard work to go with it.
There's one here, yes.
Stephen, I'd like to ask you, if I can, about your work as a composer. I listen to a lot of music in my life, including serious contemporary music. And I've asked myself, has this piece been written with me in mind as the audience? Has it been written with the performers in mind? Or has it been written just because the composer has felt compelled to write it? So my question, have you written any music for me to listen to? And if so, what do you expect?
That's a great question. I hope so, of course. I think there are occasions when you write something because it has to come out. And I think this is true of words too. And there are people who've written music or words and never shown it to anyone and it's stayed in a drawer. And there is that. But on the whole, I think you write music because you want to speak to someone. You write a novel because you want someone to read it, because you have something to communicate. And so, yeah, on the other hand, I think you would want to be challenged by something too, whether it's a novel. I mean, you don't just want something that's so bland that it kind of just... It's both, really. And I think the greatest music works in this way. It works with the head and the heart. It has an intellectual importance, but it also has an emotional connection with the person who's listening to it. So I hope so. I'll have to send you a recording and see if it's true.
Might even have one already, never mind.
There's one in the front.
Yeah. Thank you. Could I just ask you about playing concertos, whether there can be conflicts between conductor and pianist over the interpretation of work? If so, how is that in practice resolved? Who's boss? Does it matter that you differ from the conductor? Could you tell us a little about that?
Yes, it's a very broad subject. It's very interesting because, well, a concerto is like chamber music in that sense. So it's sort of a string quartet written large. And just as in a string quartet there can be differences of opinion between the four players, so between the conductor and the soloist. I think that the thing is, when you're young, the conductor is the boss, and as you get older, you get a bit more clout, a bit more authority. And I now work routinely with conductors who are younger than me, and I've played the piece many more times than them, so I might be a little bit more demanding. But in the end, what I want with a conductor is not someone who just does everything I ask in a bland kind of way, nor do I want someone who disagrees with everything. I want a conflict, a good kind of tension. And I think with the great conductors that I work with, that's true. I want to learn something new about the piece from what they have to say, but I hope also that they'll take on board my feelings. And so between the two of us, we can create something which comes alive. And this is certainly very true with the great symphonic works like the Brahms concertos, which are symphonies for piano and orchestra. There you need both. You can't have a conductor who's just looking around, am I okay, am I with you, and just tell me if there's anything. No, you have to have someone who creates something. With the Brahms D minor, the conductor is conducting for 5 minutes before you come in. So something has to be said. But then it has to be this dialogue as well, and that's what makes a thrilling collaboration. And I've certainly had experiences of all kinds, conductors that I've felt a great conflict with in a bad way, conductors who just weren't able to do what they needed to keep the orchestra with their conception and with what I wanted to do. And then the wonderful occasions when it just feels like a creative process.
Yeah. We've got one in the there and then one in the front. Yeah.
Stephen, you have this amazing discography and particularly marked by your exploration of less well-known composers like Mompou and Shevchenko. I wondered if there was a particular recording of your own that you would most like to stand the test of posterity.
Oh, that's an interesting point. Well, I think the Mompou CD that I made was something that I feel very affectionate about. I remember it as a very sunny day. We were recording in St. George's, Bristol, which is a beautiful building and a beautiful acoustic, and we had a fantastic piano. And it was just one of those recordings that went very smoothly and easily, a couple of takes of each piece, and we just went on to the next and to the next. And as each one passed, I felt in a better mood. So I have very good memories of that recording. I think in some ways, the Hummel Concertos was a recording, was one of my first recordings. Those pieces had not been recorded complete up to that point. And these are pieces that were central repertoire in the time of Chopin and Schumann and Brahms, all three of whom played Hummel. And by the late 20th century, no one really knew much about him except for the trumpet concerto. So that was a recording that I enjoyed. And also another obscure one, I think York Bowen was another recording. Many of those pieces only existed in old manuscript copies that had never been published. There was very little York Bowen available on CD. So that felt nice to work with. So I would say probably those three were things that I hope that recording them made a difference to other people who went on afterwards to do more.
As the owner of at least two out of three of those, I can certainly endorse the choices.
Thanks. Thank you.
And then in the front here.
Go back to the issue of conductors. Have you ever wanted to direct from the piano and sort of cut out the middleman, as it were?
Or woman.
Or woman, exactly. Yes. Or do you like having the sort of security of having somebody to guide the orchestra?
It's not so much the security. It's with a good conductor. It's just more than you. It's an added dimension, which I think is exciting to have that kind of collaboration. I have directed from the keyboard. I've done a couple of tours. I did a tour last with the Irish Chamber Orchestra, and I've worked with the Royal Academy and also with the Liverpool Philharmonic. What's wonderful about conducting and directing from the keyboard is the rehearsals, because then you are actually working with the orchestra and really, in a sense, coaching them. And so you really are able to work with your own idea of the piece. And it can be very frustrating in a rehearsal if a conductor's asking the orchestra to do something that you don't actually want them to do. And you can't really stand up and say, well, actually, I want completely the opposite of that. But in the concert, I really prefer having the conductor there. I think it's in a sense, enough to focus on playing the notes. And I just find that I having someone there is actually helps, not in security, but in inspiration.
I think we can take one or two more. And then, oh, there's one in the front with Andy, and one in the back.
Nowadays, the performer and the composers tend to be two different figures.
Yeah.
So it's clearly not the case for you, but in most cases, that's how it works today. So do you think that this kind of specialization is needed today because we have a huge repertoire? Do you think there are benefits in doing both? Is there a value added for being both a composer and a performer, or those are still two different jobs and you just happen to like both of them?
Well, it's certainly true that until about the 1940s, I can't think of anyone who performed and didn't compose. I mean, it just was unthinkable. And certainly in the earlier 19th century, if you went to a city and said, well, I play the piano, they would say, well, play some of your music then. And, oh, well, I don't compose. What? Oh, well, what do you mean? Because the idea of only playing other people's music was, well, it was a little bit like the jazz world. You know, there are no jazz musicians who only play other people's arrangements of they play their own. I mean, that because that's what we bring them along for. So we've lost a little bit of that. And I understand why. And I don't think it's necessarily impoverished us, but I think it impoverishes people if they don't compose as well. And I really do think that however badly you compose, everyone should write music. Because it's, you know, if you can read music, you can write music. It's like words. You might not write great essays, but anyone can write an essay. It's a technique. And so writing a fugue is a technique. I can give you a theme for a fugue, and you should be able to write one. So I think this is an important thing. It's important sometimes, and not with the greatest instrumentalists, but sometimes with students, you can tell they've never written because of the way they look at what the composer has written. It's not that you need to reverence it in a sort of repressive kind of way, but you know, if a composer's written a crescendo there rather than there, and if it's a composer who really knows what he's doing, then I think if you've worked with those ideas yourself, it makes you look at the score in a different way. So I do think that's important. And I certainly, for many years, for 20 years, I wrote virtually nothing from the age of 20 to 40 because I thought, well, I'm not a composer and I don't have time and all of these other excuses. And I wrote little transcriptions that I played as encores. And then gradually I started writing more music and I started to love it. And the more you write, the more you can write. Again, that's part of the technique. It's like writing words, isn't it? That when you're at university and you're writing essays, you know, you actually start being able to write essays. You start to get fluent with it. So I think we should definitely. Yeah.
All right. Maybe one more at the back, and then I'm going to ask you some very very quick pop quiz questions.
Could you tell me what you think about the technical and oral skills of pianists such as Oscar Peterson and Art Tatum, and why those skills particularly are so difficult to access within the standard or the current piano pedagogy?
Questions about the technique of Oscar Peterson and Art Tatum. I should tell you just before I answer a nice story I heard about Oscar Peterson, who was very prodigious from a very young age and had this extraordinary playing. His father put on a record of Art Tatum, and Oscar Peterson said he fell into a great gloom when his father told him it was only one person playing. And then a week after that, just as he was recovering, his father told him that Art Tatum was blind, and it then took about a month. But anyway, so jazz, well, technique.
They're two incredible pianists. But I think that we still have wonderful pianists around in the jazz world too. I mean, Gonzalo Rubalcaba, for instance, who was in London, unfortunately wasn't around, has a technique to equal those two. And, you know, I don't think we're lacking that. As far as digital things, people say, though, that now technique is better than it was in the classical world, than it was in the years when people wrote that book. And I would really dispute that. Because I think what often we lack now is color and texture and pedaling and so on. When you hear someone like Ignaz Friedman or Rachmaninoff playing, and this is only from 78, so you can still hear it, there is something going on there that is equal to and possibly greater than anything that's happening today. So I don't think it's a sort of evolution that everything's always getting better. So we should be careful about that. And of course, Art Tatum was playing at least three generations ago, so...
Yeah. Right. Well, thank you very much. I'm going to ask you very, very quick fire questions just to finish with Steve. Mm-hmm. Binary choices, you're not allowed to say both.
Goodness, so this is very tricky.
Bach or Beethoven?
Beethoven.
Okay. The Beatles or Rolling Stones?
Beatles.
Schumann or Schubert?
Schubert, I think.
Panama or Trilby? I know you like hats.
Trilby.
Trilby. Crossroads or Coronation Street?
Coronation Street.
Oh, really? Okay. And last, and think carefully about this, London or New York?
Oh, that's the hardest one.
Don't fall at the final hurdle, Stephen. So many right answers so far.
Well, you know, it's interesting, as a northerner, my father would like me to say New York.
There you are. Very, very diplomatic. That's really good. Stephen, I would have to cut it off. I could go on for hours. It's been an enormous pleasure to have you in. I'm sure everyone here has enjoyed it. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you so much.
Quick
yeah, of course. Yeah, there's no rush.